Starting with BHP Billiton, which is the world's largest diversified natural resources group, combined market cap here of 1.3 trillion rand, trades on a PE of 38.8 and a dividend yield of 3%.
What we mean by combined market cap is you have to take the Australian and US entity which trades in that market and then London and South Africa, add them together. But remember, this company done an enormous amount of house cleaning. It's done a lot of asset dispositions. It's really all about iron ore. It's about copper in South America. The iron ore is in Australia mostly. And then, of course, the oil and gas.
Let's have a look at that share price graph. And Paul, to your point that there's further upside, would this be one of the stocks to certainly take a stake in?
I think so, yes. It's obviously diversified. It's global. If you're going to take a bet in the sector, it's one of the safer bets to take.
You're not going to run into balance sheet problems.
No, I don't think so. I think it's fairly stable. It's paid off a lot of debt already. Its balance sheet's looking okay. It's not fantastic, but it's looking a lot better than it has been in the past. And I think, I mean, look, there are some potential short-term issues. There's a big fund manager out there who's trying to call for a sort of unbundling of certain assets and things like that. Their petroleum assets in the US in particular. But I do think long-term that's probably a good play for them as well. So, you know, where they are strategically at the moment, I think it's a good company. I think they will make the most of, if you're going to look at a company that's going to make the most of a cyclical recovery, I think Billiton's definitely one to have.
Paul, this should be something that we consider seriously now, because if there is going to be an uptick in the cycle, BHP Billiton is poised to benefit with its diversification across the resource spectrum.
Look, when I say they, so they focused on first tier assets in their chosen markets. The iron ore assets are fantastic. The only person or company that has similar heft is Rio Tinto. China is remaining fairly buoyant. We did see a good solid GDP read. But the questions remain.
Here comes the but.
Escondida, the Chilean copper asset, they've had some labor issues. Copper markets looked a bit spongy. It's had some moments. The oil assets are interesting because the traditional ones, the onshore and offshore oil and gas participations in platforms have been fine. But some of the natural gas onshore stuff that they bought, you know, in the past decade, I'm sure they wish they'd never even considered, because they've taken some write-downs there. I don't know. I mean, I think it's by far not a foregone conclusion that it's going to be sunny and optimistic from here, because what are we saying? Are you expecting demand, for example, in Chinese steel industry just to be much
Just if I may add, we've got to focus now on the demand side of the equation,
yes,
because the cost-cutting cycle has probably been done,
and
that's kind of as much as can be done.
I think if you look, I think people are overplaying China a little bit too much. Yes, they are the biggest consumer of these products, but if you look at global GDP, it's forecast to be above 3.5% this year. Now, historically, that says if you look at global GDP above those numbers, you get an exponential increase in particular base metals prices. So I think that's going to bode well for all these companies. Whether that happens or not remains to be seen. Look, they do have a few other issues. They've still got the Samarco debacle that they're trying to get through. That's not up and running again yet.
Just talk to that for a moment. Yeah. I mean, explain for the viewers, that was a dam that burst,
the
Brazilian government wants to impose a fine of some enormous proportion.
Absolutely.
How's that going to get resolved?
So no one actually knows yet. They're not actually sure what that cost is going to be to them yet. But I think in the whole scheme of things, I don't think it's material in the whole scheme of things if you start looking at where potentially these metal prices can go to. I think they've come, if you look globally, over the last 10 years, they've come off a long way. We're underestimating how much they've actually come off. Yes, they've recovered a lot in the short term.
But there could still be significant upside on the underlying metal prices themselves.
Absolutely.
Hot or not, Paul?
I'm hot. I'm hot in the stock.
Paul, one important.
Say not hot. I've got a feeling that it's had a little surge, and I'm not 100% convinced it can maintain that.
It's going to take a while to convince you to dip your toe into resources.